You have a purpose, and you're not too old or too far gone to find it and live it. In fact, every single thing that you've gone through equips you to be able to do what you were born to do.
Welcome back to the Find Your Purpose Now podcast. I'm so glad that you're here. So I think today it's time to focus on the role that mental health or mental illness plays in living your purpose. We have a mental health crisis in this country, and it's holding so many people back from living their purpose. Now, when I say mental health or mental illness, I'm talking about anxiety, depression, eating disorders. I mean, there are many, many ways that our mental health, our good frame of mind slips away from us. Post-traumatic stress disorder. I mean, there are so many things. And I'm not a mental health professional. I just am looking at this from the standpoint of how it can keep us from living the life we were born to live and doing what we were made to do. Because if we're constantly overwrought, we're distraught, we're anxious, we're fearful, we're not going to see the opportunities that are presented in front of us. Or we may see them and then we don't take them because we're afraid to take them. We're afraid to take the step. We're afraid that we're going to fail. We're afraid that we're going to lose our good reputation. What will people say? What will people think? What's going to happen? It's a common thing in the United States, and it's profoundly sad. And it's time that we, all of us, including Christians, maybe especially Christians, start talking about this, because according to the Anxiety and Depression Association of America, yeah, there is that. They say that 264 million people struggle with depression. I mean, we're talking about the United States alone. 264 million people. And 40 million people struggle with anxiety. So between depression and anxiety, wow, there are a lot of people struggling with this stuff. So one of the first things I want to say is, you know, for Pete's sake, let's not judge anybody. If this isn't you, if you don't struggle with anxiety or depression or the residual of trauma that you've been through, then God bless you. Good for you. I hope you don't. But there are people all around us, literally, according to these numbers, there are people all around us who do. I've heard the statistic that more than 50% of Americans take some kind of medication to deal with depression or anxiety. Think of that. So it doesn't mean that there's something wrong with these people, that they've done something to deserve it. I mean, we have to stop that. There's no shame in experiencing some kind of mental illness. Let me be really, really clear about this. There's no shame in heart disease, diabetes, high blood pressure, getting the flu, getting COVID. Can we just stop judging people? Good heavens. So any of us can be subject to depression, fear, anxiety, worry. I don't think there's a human being alive who hasn't been worried about something at some point in time. I don't think there's a single person, adult, who hasn't lost a night's sleep worrying about something. We worry about elderly parents. We worry about teenagers. doing the wrong thing, making some irreparable mistake. We worry about whether or not we're going to be able to pay our bills, if we're going to get laid off on our job, if our spouse is cheating, you know, whatever, you name it. We worry. So this is just a thing that it's a condition. It's a part of the human condition. And it has been since probably the beginning of time. So let's not judge. Let's not put people down and say, well, you know, they must not be believers, or they must be doing something wrong. It must be something that they brought on themselves. Because that's just not the way to approach it. Okay. Now, even if somebody did, just live a selfish, self-centered life, and it led to bad consequences, and now they're living the consequences, we're still not supposed to judge people and just cast them out of our lives as believers. I mean, it doesn't mean that you have to stay in toxic or abusive relationships. You can love somebody from a distance, but we're supposed to love people. We're supposed to be merciful and patient and long-suffering, gentle, humble. We're supposed to be all those things. In terms of depression, anxiety, suicidal thoughts even, the evidence that I can point to that this has been going on forever goes back to the prophet Elijah in the Old Testament of the Bible, talking about Elijah had just gone and done amazing things, and he sat down and literally prayed to God that he would die. He said, "I've had enough, Lord. Take my life." Okay, so if Elijah, the prophet of God, had suicidal ideation, then any of us can have it too. These things are often triggered by trauma. A divorce, the death of someone that we were not ready to let go of, job loss, any kind of a tragedy. Of course, it's a natural thing for us to be sad and grieve whatever we've lost. And when we grieve, we don't just lose the person, or the thing, the job, whatever. We grieve also not only the present loss, but the loss of what we thought was going to be the future. If you had in mind, for example, that you're going to marry a certain person and you're going to, you know, buy a house with a little white picket fence and you're going to have 2.5 children and you're going to have this kind of job and this kind of life, and that's what you're living for, that's what you're looking forward to, that's what your goals and plans and dreams involve, and then that person cheats on you, or that person leaves with somebody else. Now, not only did you lose the person and you lost the relationship, maybe you lost your best friend, the love of your life, you also lose that dream in your mind and in your heart of the house with the picket fence and the children, all those things that will never be. And that's hard. And so I think we have to be kind and gentle and merciful to ourselves, to others who are experiencing sadness, that depression, anxiety, whatever it is, that they're just for a time unwell. And I say for a time because, you know, when we get the flu, we don't expect to have the flu for the rest of our lives. We go to bed and get rest and try to drink plenty of water, and maybe we go to the doctor and whatever it is that we do, but we try to treat it and move on. Of course, there are some kinds of conditions. For example, I mean, it's a crazy, it's an out there example, but you know, let's say you're in a car accident and your leg has to be amputated. Okay, well, but what do? You treat the situation you move on. And when I say move on, I'm not necessarily saying, hey, everything's going to go back to the old normal. No, in some situations, it doesn't, and it won't. But that doesn't mean that the new normal, the new future, is not going to be good. Might be amazing. Because it's in the difficulties of our lives that we learn the most profound lessons. Very often, beautiful things are found in the broken pieces of what we've lost. Like, for example, meeting someone that you would not have otherwise met, who enriches your life in ways that you never could have seen coming. Let's look at what the Bible says. I mean, when I don't know about something, I often will turn to God's word. I mean, it's been around for thousands of years. It's never let me down. It works for me. So I want to try to understand what the Bible says about mental illness. It does talk about mental illness. You might be surprised to know that. I mentioned Elijah before. I already told you that one. That's in 1 Kings chapter 9, verse 4, where Elijah is basically saying to God, all right, I'm done. Take my life. But when you read a little further in 1 Kings chapter 19, it says God did not take Elijah's life, but rather gave him the strength to keep going. God helped Elijah by providing him with a good nap and a good meal. Okay, I may be just a complete simpleton, but what that says to me is when we don't feel well mentally, we need to eat healthy, get plenty of rest, take care of ourselves, and kind of recharge before we go back out into the world and continue to pursue living out our purpose. The Bible also talks specifically about anxiety. This is in New Testament, 1 Peter, chapter 5, verse 7 says, cast all your anxiety on him, Jesus, because he cares for you. God wants you to give all of your worries, cares, and concerns to him. If you humble yourself under his mighty hand, which basically means do what he says do, and Jesus said the most important commandment is to love one another, live a life of love, then he will uphold you and strengthen you. Another Bible passage that speaks about anxiety is Philippians 4, verses 6 and 7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with gratitude, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all human understanding, will then guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Okay, now that's a promise that I have lived on my whole life. And I've had plenty of opportunity to be anxious, lots and lots and lots of situations. Times when I had a physical condition and I didn't think I was going to live. Times when my husband was not expected to live. Times when my only child was in the depths of depression, all the way to suicidal ideation. And when your only child wants you to go with her and hold her hand when she takes her life. Now that's the cause of some anxiety right there. And I could go on and on. I had a company located in the World Trade Center on 9/11 and lost everything. And had to start all over. I've had to start all over a lot of times in my life. So I get it. I get sadness and depression, anxiety. But God's word is giving you some guidance here, some wisdom that if we pray with gratitude, so meaning with gratitude for what we do have, we have air in our lungs right now. You're listening to me so you can hear me. You have your hearing. You have options. You might think you have no options, but I'm telling you, you have options that you're not even aware of right now. So if you pray with thanksgiving for what you do have and present your request to God, then He'll give you His peace. And I'm telling you, His peace is better than any peace that you could come up with or that I've ever come up with. His peace truly does surpass all human understanding. And what I mean by that is when I was in the depths of the pit with my daughter and didn't know how it was going to end because she had a plan. Like she was determined that she was going to do this, and she had a plan, and she was an adult. There was not, and she's bigger than me. Like I physically, what can you do? You can't tie them to the bedpost or lock them in the closet. Our grown adult kids have their own free will, and they can make irreparable decisions. Everybody in your life really can make irreparable decisions. You can't change that. You can't take their free will away from them. So these people we love can literally drag our hearts into places that we would do anything to avoid going. But I have to tell you, God got us through, and He really did give me peace. Like I was able, I look back on that time in my life and I think, I don't know how I put one foot in front of the next. I don't. There's no logical explanation. There's only a supernatural explanation for how we all got through that. And now my daughter that was many years ago. She's healed. She's whole. She's happy. She's an amazing wife and mother. She's an exemplary employee for the company she works for. I mean, you would never guess in a million years that she had ever been at that low place. And I'm not speaking out of turn. She's very vocal about this, and she gives God all the credit for getting her through. It was in that moment that she told me about her plan that I was looking at her. I was making eye contact. I was looking calm on the outside, but on the inside, I was screaming out to God, asking Him to help, begging Him to help. Give me the right words in the right order. Just fill me with Your Holy Spirit. Tell me what to say, because I don't know what to say. I don't know what to do. And out of my mouth came these words, okay, I'll go with you on one condition. You turn your life over to Jesus now, and you give Jesus 30 days. I don't know where 30 days came from, but the things that were coming out of my mouth, like I'm hearing them as they're coming out of my mouth for the first time, like my daughter is. It had to be God. And I said, if nothing in your life that has brought you to this point changes in 30 days, then I'll go with you. And she agreed. And so I led her in prayer, very simple. And I just said, okay, repeat after me, Jesus, I want to believe You. I want to believe in You. I give my life to You. Take my life and do something good with it. I'm Yours. Amen. Within 48 hours, she found out she was pregnant. And the reason that she had been in the depths of depression was that 5 different doctors had told her that she would never be able to have children. And the only thing she had ever wanted to do was be a mommy. She didn't want my business. She didn't want to follow in my footsteps. She didn't want to be some high-powered career woman, although that's what she is now. Our kids are almost grown. But the thing that she had prayed so desperately for a very long time wound up becoming a reality in her life. And God healed her of that depression and anxiety. Now, does that mean that everything's perfect? No, of course not. You know, stuff still happens. Flat tires still happen. But I shared that story with you to say that I'm not speaking about this from the standpoint of somebody who's never known a bad day. I have not had a cake and ice cream life. I was raised by a mentally ill man who was extremely abusive. He had explosive rage that would come out of nowhere. His mood would shift from, okay, to extreme anger in 1.2 seconds. It was hard. I've known other people that I've cared a lot about who struggle with severe depression and at times unable to even get out of bed. I understand that depression can be situational, but it could also be chemical. It could also be, I guess, part of the genetics. Either way, God walks with us. None of what we go through in this human condition is a surprise to him. Think about that. I'm not saying he causes any of this. We live in a broken world. And evil is real. And there are people who do bad things. And bad things can happen to good people. That's a whole other conversation. But what I know to be true for me is, here's more of what the Bible says about this. When I have been in those kinds of situations where, it's the middle of the night and you can't sleep because you have no idea what fresh, new, horrific thing is going to happen the next day because you're in the hot mess middle of something that you have no idea how in the world to get out of. For me, when I've had those nights, I look at the Psalms, especially the 23rd Psalm. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. For me, the rod and the staff, I envision some big, strong angel from God standing there with this rod, giant, ready to fight off evil. And the staff, like a shepherd's staff that stands, 12 feet tall, so that above the crowd, above the noise, I can see it and I can follow it and I know the right way to go. I love that God's word says that he's always with us. No matter where we are, no matter what we're going through. And the most remarkable thing, and I've lived long enough to say that this is true. I mean, unequivocally true. Psalm 30:11 says that God can turn your sadness into joy, like dancing joy. Joyful dancing. And that's been the truth for me. I've gone from the night of wondering if my daughter would still be alive in the next 24 hours. I've gone through those dark nights where my husband was in the ICU and they called and said, "We don't think he's going to make it through the night. You probably want to get here." And that was 20 years ago. And we're celebrating his life and our marriage, and he's going strong. He's healthy. He's great. I have seen sadness turn into joy. I'm living it. I'm living the joy now because I'm living in my purpose. And I'm not saying that to brag. You can have that too. God is not a respecter of persons, meaning he doesn't discriminate. When people choose to believe, and you know what? Honestly, it's okay if you choose to believe because it's your very last hope. That's okay. It doesn't matter if you reach out to God in the first moment of a trial. I do that now. Or if you reach out to God as a last recourse. I mean, it's a lot easier, honestly, I'm just telling you. It's easier if you start with God. But don't be one of those people who says, no, I can't pray. It wouldn't be right. I haven't prayed in my whole life. Now I'm going to, you know, be in this situation. Now I'm going to pray. Yes. Yes. Exactly. You're still breathing. So you're still in the game. And there's still a purpose for your life. No matter what has happened, no matter what you've done, no matter what's been done to you, there is still a good purpose that can come from all of it. I guess the only thing I can say is to ask you to trust me on this. My life is evidence of it. And there are many, many, many more of us whose lives are evidence of God's ability to turn sadness, depression, anxiety, PTSD, you name it. I mean, don't we have a diagnosis? Don't we have some name for every single thing nowadays? My word. And God can turn all of it around. You were made in God's image. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. Mental health can be triggered by the world we live in, by our culture, by comparing ourselves to others, comparing what we have to what other people have. This is why your purpose is so incredibly important, because you were not made to live somebody else's life, somebody else's purpose. There's nothing wrong with being happy for somebody else, being proud of them, being inspired by them, being happy for them, okay? But don't turn that back on yourself and be sad because you don't have their fabulous life. You have your life. Each of us. This is the life we were given. These are the cards we were dealt. It's up to us to make the best out of our situation, to find ways to help others, to love others. Our purpose is found in that. And you've heard me talk so many times about finding the clues to your purpose in the really hard things that have happened to you. Maybe whatever mental illness, diagnosis, whatever label has been slapped on your head. First of all, I don't want to believe that every single label is right. People are misdiagnosed all the time. So don't just accept some label slapped on you and roll over and say, oh, this is it for me for the rest of my life. Come on. No. Whether you've, you know, the example I used earlier, if you've lost a limb, if you've had something amputated, if you've gotten diagnosed with some kind of a mental illness, if you're dealing with some other chronic physical ailment, whatever it is, let us not roll over like a roly-poly bug and just say, oh, poor me, this is it for me for the rest of my life. Let's not. Okay, I'm not saying ignore it and pretend like it's not there. No, let's deal with it. But let's try to bring good from it. Maybe it gives us empathy for other people who have it worse than we do. Maybe it positions us to give an opportunity to somebody else to help us. It's okay to ask for help. It's okay to receive help. And like Elijah, like over it in the desert, asking God to die, the idea of resting up and eating healthy and drinking plenty of water and, you know, just letting ourselves be recharged before we go back out in the pursuit of our purpose. Let's do that. I really believe that if we will pray with thanksgiving, seek help, don't be afraid to seek help. There's no shame. There's no stigma. We've got to get past that in this country. If we will train ourselves to think good thoughts, and you can do that, you can change your thoughts. And I know a lot of people go, no, you can't. Yes, you can. I did. You can change your thoughts. You can train yourself to do it, like you can change the channel on the TV with your clicker. When a bad thought, when a destructive thought comes to your mind, you can intentionally capture that thought and say, no, I'm not going to think about that. I'm going to think about this. And what I do, I mean, have your good things lined up. Maybe it's a funny TV show. Maybe it's a super suspenseful mystery novel that holds your attention. Maybe it's a movie. Maybe it's YouTube videos that make you laugh. Whatever works for you. Maybe it's calling a friend, going and meeting in the park and sit with somebody and listen to the birds sing. Go fishing. I love going fishing. Whatever it is that you enjoy doing, change your thought and think about that. Think about that thing. Don't give negative, ugly, evil thoughts real estate in your brain. You have the control over your mind and your thoughts. And if you don't think that you do, I want to point you toward Viktor Frankl's book, Man's Search for Meaning. He was imprisoned in a Nazi death camp in World War II. And he survived it because he refused to let them take his attitude, his thoughts. He controlled his thoughts under the most severe conditions, watching his family be killed, watching people around him give up and die. Okay? We're not in that situation. So if he could do it, we could do it. The Bible says to think good thoughts. Finally, brothers and sisters, this is in Philippians 4:8. Whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely and admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about these things. So you have the power to control your thoughts. And if you have to change the channel in your mind every 3 seconds, do it. Eventually, it'll come naturally. One last scripture that I want to leave you with. It's in Ephesians in chapter 6, verses 10 through 18. It's about putting on the full armor of God to stand up against evil, because evil is real. All we have to do is think about people buying and selling children for sex to know and be reminded that there is real evil in the world. But we can protect ourselves against evil by putting on the helmet of salvation, meaning accept the free gift of salvation of Jesus, putting on the breastplate of righteousness. That breastplate in a set of armor was the thing that protected your heart and your lungs. The breastplate of righteousness, what's righteousness? It's making right choices and treating people well. It's simple. The belt of truth. Tell the truth. None of this is that complicated. It can be hard to tell the truth when you know there's going to be blowback from it, but tell the truth. The shoes of peace. Be peaceful. Contribute to peace, meaning don't be arguing all the time. It's not your job to correct people or make people see your point of view or agree with you. Just live in peace. Let people have their own free will. God gave them free will, gave you free will. Let's let them have it. Let's let them believe what they want to believe. I know about the Great Commission while I'm saying this. I know there are believers listening to this going, wait a minute. You know, we've been told to go out and tell people about the Lord. Yes, that's true. But we don't have to argue about it. We can tell people and then let them decide. The shield of faith, part of that armor, lifting the shield of faith to quench the fiery darts of the enemy is what the word of God says. So there are fiery darts, you know, just horrible things that happen, that can happen. We know about that. Look at crime statistics in your city, you know, rapes, murders, robberies, okay, all of the above. They're everywhere. So you lift up your shield of faith, believing that God is with you, will never leave you, loves you, thinks you're precious. And then wield the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. So we fight the evil that's in the word, or the world, with the word of God, the blood of Jesus that was shed for us, and the word of our testimony, our gratitude for what God has done in our lives, by sharing what we've been through, by being real and authentic about what we've been through, because we're on the other side of it. God did come through for us. That's why I tell the stories that I tell. I would prefer not to, honestly. I'm an introvert. I would rather that everything in my life be kept completely private. Well, that train left the station after 15 books. But the point is, it's the word of my testimony. It's my testimony of what God has done in my life. And if I wrote about every single prayer that God has ever answered in my life, oh, I'd be writing until I took my last breath. It's truly remarkable. It's miracle after miracle, really. Because what's a miracle after all? It's an answered prayer. And in order to have miracles, you have to have a difficult, seemingly impossible situation that you're dealing through and trying to live through. And I've had that, a lot of that. And God has granted miracle after miracle in my life, the lives of my loved ones, people around me, people I've prayed for, including people who the medical people had said, we have nothing more for you. And they were cured. I mean, these are medically documented miracles. And I know that a lot of people roll their eyes and they're skeptical. I was raised by atheists. I'm fully aware of skepticism. In fact, I shared it for a long time. But you know, when you've been in the middle of praying desperately for something, for somebody, and it happens, you know, like you get the miracle, then it's too late for somebody to try to convince you that there's no miracles or that God doesn't exist, because it's like saying that Newport Beach, California doesn't exist. And I lived there for 20 years. Too late. I know it's real. I live in the life that I have now, which is truly a miracle. The amazing life that I have now. And the many, many things that I've been delivered from. I mean, I was homeless when I was 8 years old. Beaten and burned and abused. And now I have this wonderful life. And it's not because I was so smart. I mean, I report for duty every day and I pray and I try to pay attention to what happens after I pray. And I do what I think I've been led to do. Meaning, if I feel like, you know, I get some random thought about I should call this one or email that one or I should go here or there or whatever, I do it. I just do it. I didn't always, but I don't question it now. I do what I feel God, like the Holy Spirit of God, is leading me to do. And unbelievable, I mean, truly remarkable things have happened as a result of that. So that's just what I do every single day. So pray, listen, and then act on what you hear. And that's really the path, the lifelong path to finding and living your purpose. And while you're doing all that, love God, love yourself, and love others. And that's the key. I hope this is helpful to you. If it is, I hope that you'll subscribe, come back. I'd love to hear from you, your thoughts, your questions. Maybe even join me on the podcast if you'd like. There's a link in the description that you can send me a voice message, or you could always go to my website, Rhonda, rhonda.org, and send me a message there, and I'd love to hear from you. Thanks for being here today, and see you next week.
Every single thing that you've gone through equips you to be able to do what you were born to do. The things that you've been through have changed the way you see the world. They've qualified you to do what you were born to do and perfectly matched to do. Is there anything more important than finding and living the purpose for which you were born? I don't think so. I think that's the point.